Welcome. This is a production brought to you by the Idaho Commission on Aging. Presented by Aaron Olson. And in partnership with the listed community panelists.
Well, the first day of fall is actually next week, but it sure is feeling like we're already into fall here, at least down in the Treasure Valley. That went from 102, 103 record-setting days last week to, I think, 50s and 70s for the high. So fall is definitely here. I'd like to welcome everyone to the Idaho Commission on Aging's Stay Healthy, Simple Steps to Improve Balance and Reduce Fall seminar. That's kind of a mouthful, but we're actually going to make it simple, even though the title is long. We know that we're all transitioning from that summer to fall, whether that's for work or school or our personal pursuits. So I guess it's always a busy time for most of us, and that's why we want to extend our appreciation for your willingness to invest an hour or so of your time to expand your knowledge about this really, really important topic. And if you don't know why it's an important topic, you will in the next 5 minutes or so, because that's why we're here. We recognize the importance of, you know, remaining physically active. We hear that all the time, but the more I've studied and been involved with aging, it's just everything comes down to really being physically active as much as we can. It literally impacts every part of our physical and our mental health, far beyond just preventing falls. That's why it's so important. It's why we created this seminar last year, and we're proud to present it again this year as well, year two. Our phenomenal presenter, Kate Wilson, is with us again this year. We're glad to have Kate back, and you're going to hear a lot from her in a few minutes. We have modified the content a little bit, though, so even if you joined us last year, it will still be new and refreshed and exciting. With that, let me move to our next slide, and I'm now doing this all on my own, so give me a little bit of a chance. We always have to give credit, so I'll try to make this as important or as simple as we can as well. It's always a great day to learn how to be falls free. We should be focusing on that a little bit every day. We know that remaining physically active is the one thing, the number one thing we can do to actually avoid or lessen those things that we all call the normal parts of aging. I'm just getting older, but actually they're not. A lot of it has to do with becoming inactive and not having proper nutrition and hydration. So we're eager to share strategies that you can employ today, starting today with us, to maintain your overall health and well-being. My name is Aaron Olson, by the way, and I work with the Idaho Commission on Aging, where I manage the health promotion program, among some other things. We provide services for older Idahoans, their families, their caregivers, and also people over age 18 with disabilities who need services and supports. I also coordinate Idaho's No Wrong Door program. If you're not sure what that is, it provides one-stop assistance for those who need long-term services and supports. Now, we're hoping by you being here and staying healthy that long-term supports aren't going to be as necessary, but if you need them, we can help provide them as well. These programs are actually funded through the Administration for Community Living, or ACL, and the National Commission on Aging, or NCOA. They support the National Falls Prevention Program as well. ACL and NCOA are actually going to be celebrating all of their stuff next week. They do Falls Prevention Week, starting in whatever week the first day of fall is on the calendar. Here in Idaho, we've celebrated Falls Prevention Awareness Month, though, for the past 3 years. There's just too much to talk about to limit it to just a week, and we don't want to cram it all in. That's also why I'm very eager, excited, and proud to announce that we have officially established, gone to the first steps of developing the Falls Prevention Coalition of Idaho. This will allow us to build a statewide network to address public and professional education about falls year-round, and we'll be able to more thoroughly share information about the significant outcomes and impacts of falls. So with all of that stuff said, we will move on to our next slide. And this is just a little bit about our logistics. We always have to go through the logistics. So first of all, if you have questions, we do have a Q&A panel that you can open, ask your questions there. Technically, sometimes you can put them in chat, but it's much easier to keep chat and questions separated if we just use the chat panel. And we're going to let Kate get to all of those wonderful answers at the end. That would be time permitting, of course. The next thing that people always want to know about is, can we have a copy of the slides? I mean, I bet every single meeting and seminar and webinar that you've been in the last 3 years, people always ask, can we have a copy of the slides? So yes, you absolutely can. They will be on our website. I'm going to say this URL a few times. It is http://aging.idaho.gov/falls. And there you will find not only a copy of the slides, you will also find a bio on our wonderful expert, Kate. And when it's ready, you will also find a link to the recording of our webinar. So that's going to be your super resource for getting all of that information. We also do a resource guide for all of the seminars that we provide. There's four of them. We do a combined resource guide so that you can have all kinds of information and links available to you that we honestly just can't all put into our seminars or that let you kind of look into things in more depth than you may have done otherwise. Now, we don't like to talk about this, but we have to talk about a technical emergency. So, you know, all of this has a lot of tech running behind it. So far, everything seems to be running okay. But if you have issues and get disconnected, please just log in again. Fortunately, we will have that recording and a copy of the slides. So if you miss a couple of things, you'll be able to catch up on those. If we happen to lose a panelist, which would be Kate, I'm going to do my best to fill up a few minutes while she gets reconnected. So that can always be fun because she is the expert on this particular topic. I am not, but everybody who knows me knows I can certainly talk to fill time. I'll try to make it valuable, though. If we have some kind of problem with what I like to call the mothership, which is here at ICOA, our Zoom account, all that wonderful behind the scenes stuff, then be patient. We again will try to get logged on as quickly and soon as we can to continue. If we have a technology catastrophe and that is not possible, we will send you an email at some point after the seminar time, letting you know when we will reschedule it. So that's kind of what we have in mind if we ever have to have an emergency, but the best part of having emergency plans is not ever having to use them. So we will now move on with additional topic. As I said, we are recording this seminar, so this is our official notification that we are recording the seminar. Keep all those lawyers happy if they ever want to know. More importantly, it's just about the fact that you will have a copy of the seminar when we're all finished that you can refer back to or share with other people, which will be great. What are we going to discuss? Well, we're going to let Kate take over in just a minute. I'm going to do a little tiny section, hopefully a quick section, on falls and what they are, just so we can understand them a little bit better. Then we're going to let Kate take over, and she's going to talk about the things that we need, like balance and strength, and take us through some of the issues like chronic conditions that can impact our falls risk. And then, of course, the big part and what makes this a unique seminar from any other that I know of is Kate's going to actually lead us through demonstrations on some simple at-home exercises or at-office exercises that we can do to help us maintain that strength, flexibility, and balance that is going to be so critical. Time permitting, we will then go to that Q&A pod and try to answer some of your questions that you may have for Kate. So With all that said, I'm going to take a deep breath because I tend to talk quickly through the section. I need to relax a bit. And I'll say, are you ready? Then let's get on to some good information. As we said, we really need to understand what falls are. And that's really the focus of our next seminar, which is happening on Tuesday, understanding why falls are there and why they happen, and also, again, how to prevent them. So we go into a lot of depth on the causes and prevention there. But we today need to know why we should care about doing these exercises to prevent falls as well. And that's what we'll get to in just a couple more minutes. So the first thing we need to know is, what is a fall? It's unintentionally moving downward, typically rapidly or freely, without control, from a higher to a lower level. Now, that may sound like an academic definition, and it actually is. But the reason it's important is because if I were to ask all of you what a fall is, we'd get a bunch of different answers. They'd all be different. What we also know is that older people, especially, tend to not want to say they've fallen. There is a fear that if they admit they've fallen, that they're going to, you know, lose independence, that they're going to be worried about, that you're going to try to tell them that they shouldn't be doing certain things. And that can be scary. So they don't admit that they've fallen. As a matter of fact, half of people who have had falls that even have injuries don't even tell their doctor that it happened. So this is just going to help us kind of get that communication down where we want it to be, so we can all understand what a fall is. So we're all talking about the same thing. Now, there's some important parts to this definition. The first is that it doesn't happen slowly. Usually it's something that happens quickly and it's uncontrolled. Also that it is something that we didn't plan. Believe it or not, we usually don't plan our falls. They just sort of happen. Then the second part is that gravity takes over. We are always moving in a fall from a higher plane to a lower plane. Now, that does not mean that you have to be standing and fall to the floor, or standing and falling to the couch. You could simply be standing, trip, slip, and all of a sudden you're leaning against the wall. That is lower than you were before. So don't let people try to say, well, it doesn't really count because I didn't end up on the floor. It doesn't matter. If you're going from higher to lower, as long as we're on Earth and gravity's playing its part, then that is an important part of the fall. So what does that mean? It means that when somebody stumbles because they trip over the edge of the carpet in their living room and they kind of move forward and put their hands down on the couch and then quickly sit down, technically, that's a fall. Now, the good news is there weren't any injuries involved with it, but it was uncontrolled, unexpected, and moving from a higher to a lower plane. Try to get people to understand that when you're talking about falls, it's not about making them feel bad or making them feel like you think they're frail. It just is a way of communicating clearly about what's happening. Now, I do have to give you just a couple of little facts about falls, primarily because they're important, okay? The first thing is that we all fall more as we grow older, or at least our potential for it is that we will fall more as we grow older. And we're going to try to do something about that if we can. But 1 in 3 older adults fall at least once a year. That's higher than the national average. And once you fall, you're more than twice as likely to fall again in the same year. That is really, really important, I think. The second thing that we can talk about is the fact that, you know, there are things that impact our falls risk. I like to, you know, let people know I'm not, you know, preaching from high on the pulpit saying I'm perfect. I am a type 1 diabetic, have been since I was 5. I have multiple sclerosis, and I'm also blind. So that's 3 things that directly impact my falls risk. As a matter of fact, I have fallen more than 5 times this year. And fortunately, no significant injuries. But that means I am definitely at a high fall risk, and I'm doing things in my life to try to slow down, be more aware of, and helping myself so that I don't fall as much. Part of that is doing what Kate's going to talk about here in a few minutes, making sure that my lower body strength, especially in my balance, are good so that if I do begin to trip, that I can recover before a fall actually happens. So those are just a few of the things that we wanted to talk about, because falls result in some pretty bad things, unfortunately. It's the number one cause of hip fractures. Over 90% of hip fractures are from falling. It is a major reason that people, especially older people, end up in the emergency room. It also is the number one cause of traumatic brain injury. And that is definitely something that is not just I fell and I got a bruise and it was gone in a week. That is definitely life altering. Unfortunately, falls also usually end up in a shortened lifespan for older adults. And there's a bunch of reasons for that. Again, register for our next seminar if you want to know about it. But that's why we're concerned about falls and falling, and why we want to let our good friend Kate get us into some good shape for that. The good news is, of course, that we can prevent falls. All of them are preventable. We just have to be aware of them and take some pretty simple steps to be able to avoid falls from happening in the first place. That is the key. You know, it's not trying to recover from a fall. It's avoiding falls by doing a few simple things. So with that, I am very, very proud to introduce you to Kate. Met her last year. She's been working with us for the past year. She has a nursing background, but she currently works up in northern Idaho in our health district doing fit and fall proof classes. She's a coordinator there. And she's going to tell you a little bit about what fit and fall proof is. So I'm going to go ahead and say, Kate, why don't you let me stop talking about the not so interesting stuff, the facts and figures, and let you take it away.
Thank you so much, Erin. I think you're talking about very important stuff. As a matter of fact, I might hit on some of those points again here, because I think it's important that we consider what contributes to falls so that we are motivated to try to take these actions to prevent them. So go ahead on the next slide, please. And these may be some things that you've heard before that are risks that put you at a higher risk for falling, but let's kind of talk about why. So when we think about sensory or physical impairment, we kind of hear that buzzword chronic conditions. And what all does that encompass? We might think of things like arthritis, osteoporosis, heart disease, Erin mentioned diabetes. But why do these contribute to falls? You know, each of them has kind of their own reasoning, and I won't go in depth because I know we have another seminar for that. But if you think about arthritis, that entails joint stiffness and inflammation. That's going to affect our movement. If we think about osteoporosis, there is even new research that associates that bone loss of osteoporosis with muscle breakdown. And we all know that if we have weaker muscles, we are not as strong to stay in the positions that we need to. Heart disease, we have changes in blood pressure that can make us more prone to falling, either when we change positions or just in general, possibly with our medications. And diabetes, quite prevalent in the United States, has one of those yucky side effects called neuropathy, where we can't feel as much in our fingers or our feet. Our nerve endings become numb, so to speak. So we can't necessarily tell where we are in space quite as well. So that's what we think of as a contributing factor for our physical side of things. Medications, if you take any medications, I'm sure you're familiar with changes perhaps in medications, maybe the dosage or new medications. Now, if you take four or more This increases the likelihood that you might have side effects, or there may be interactions between certain medications that you're taking, as well as those that are prescribed for things like anxiety, depression, or pain relief. The pain-relieving medications tend to work by suppressing our central nervous system, and that reduces our alertness and causes slower reactions or movements. We all know that can be a contributing factor. We also factor in things like over-the-counter medications. Something as simple as Benadryl, maybe we're taking as an antihistamine, but causes drowsiness, one of those side effects. And it can be combined with other ingredients in over-the-counter medicines like NyQuil or Tylenol PM. If you see that PM, it kind of affects our central nervous system. So being cognizant of what all we're mixing together, important to talk to your provider or pharmacist. When Erin mentioned hydration and nutrition, that's a key factor because it may be that there's inadequate nutrition, or it could be that there's an impaired intake. In that case, maybe there's a condition where the body is not absorbing, even though you're taking in healthy foods. And if we don't have the appropriate nutrients, we certainly are more prone to fracture, poor bone density, if we do have a fall. Dehydration can cause that drop in blood pressure, even if we are not taking blood pressure altering medications. And the person may or may not even experience dizziness. The other thing to remember is that certain nerves in the mouth, throat, or stomach don't work as well with age, meaning that when we have this I'm thirsty message, it may not trigger the appropriate brain activity in an older adult. So they may feel that they're thirsty, but it may be too late, or it may not tell them to drink enough. Sometimes scheduling your water breaks is helpful for that. We see clothing here as a contributing factor. Socks. What do you wear in the house? Socks slide, first of all, and those slipper socks that we have some of us have come to like with the little grippies on the bottom, don't provide support for our ankles or feet. So thinking about what you wear around the house, maybe some indoor house shoes. Our clothing in general, if it's baggy on the bottom that bunches around the ankles or partially covers our feet, our skirts that catch our toes when we walk, those are all contributing factors. And our footwear. If there are any ladies out there who love to wear their heels, let's make sure that we have pretty strong ankle support if we're choosing to wear heels. Otherwise, as we get older, we might consider wearing something that's less than an inch for our heel. And we want non-skid soles. We want that heel to stay on our foot so that it's not flopping off with our steps. And considering the gap between our longest toe and the end of the toe box, many of us wish to be, you know, the same size, or maybe even we think we stay the same size shoe from 20 to 50 years of age. But the truth is that our feet, you know, decrease in support. Our arch loses a little support over time, and we do end up with a bigger size. So always remember to resize your foot before buying new shoes so that you have the right support. We see some pictures in this slide here as well around the home of environmental considerations. We see our loving pets as a possible factor that get underfoot, some slippery wet floor conditions, and things like rugs and cords. Navigating stairs can become challenging enough with our knees as we get older. And when items become added to the sides, the risk of falling increases for tripping over those items that are there. So I know that there was another seminar specifically on home hazards that was on Tuesday. So feel free to watch that recording to go into more detail about things you can do at home. So why is this so important? We'll go to the next slide. And I just gave us a little synopsis of information from the Lewiston Fire Department here in our area. And we know that they were looking at about this time of year, 2019 to 2020, about this time of year. And they noted that 13% of all the calls that they receive were specifically responding to falls for people 65 years or older. And what you see up here is telling us where those falls happened. So 65% of those happened in someone's home, 26% in a care facility. So we know that those environmental modifications are key because this is where people are when it happens. Next slide, please. It looks like we have a chance for a polling question.
If you want to go ahead and ask the question, Kate, we're just going to have people put their responses in the chat.
Oh, I actually don't have that list.
Oh, well, we could make up a question. You just talked about the reasons people fall. How about if we just ask all of you who are attending to put in the chat box, how many of the contributing factors, whether it's physical issues or your home, how many offhand do you think you have that you could probably improve to prevent falls? Give us a number on that. And Kate will continue.
All right. Thank you. Next slide. So we're going to talk a little bit about the balance, recovery and physiology. You know, anatomy and physiology is one of my favorite topics of science. So we'll go to the next slide and look at some of the things that are happening here. So the vestibular system is made up of so many things going on. We have the inner ear, we have the skin, our vision, and our musculoskeletal system. So how do those all work together? First, the brain has to receive signals from these mechanoreceptors. We can see a little drawing of sample that on the slide. And those are in our skin. Fluid in the cochlea of our ear canal is also sending messages, and we're getting visual stimulus from our surroundings as we rotate our head and our eyes. Then the brain must analyze all of these messages and decide what appropriate action to take in order to maintain our balance. The brain sends a signal to appropriate muscles to contract and realign the body. And this is just kind of a quick synopsis. The balance process is far more complex, particularly if there's anything affecting any of these systems. But this is kind of gives us an idea of how many working parts there are in just our balance. Next slide, please. So we talked a little bit about chronic conditions that affect, that contribute to falls. But as we look at system-specific conditions someone might be dealing with, those can affect our balance as well. So it's important to remember that people with whole body conditions, such as Parkinson's or multiple sclerosis, can experience twice the risk as falling compared to their peers, purely due to the movement symptoms that are associated with these conditions. That might be the muscle freezing or rigidity. As many as one out of two individuals with multiple sclerosis report a fall in the previous 6 months. And 30 to 50% of those who fall experience recurrent falls. That's something that Aaron mentioned earlier. So I also want to address one of the words that's under musculoskeletal box there, called sarcopenia, before we look at the fall cycle. And we can think of this as an age-related muscle weakness. So sometimes we might hear, oh, you know, I'm going to lose it anyway, right? As we age, we all lose this bone density. We all lose muscle mass. And it might feel a little defeating sometimes. And there is some very minute truth to that, in that if there's a condition or injury where nerves are damaged, the nerves then can't trigger muscle contractions that are needed to stimulate that muscle activity. And when your muscles don't contract on a regular basis, your body starts to think you don't need them anymore. And we start to see that atrophy. So it can be, it can affect during our aging process, but let's take a look at the fall cycle on the next slide to understand that a little bit more. So if we're thinking about a central nervous system condition, such as Parkinson's or multiple sclerosis, just as our example here, maybe that person begins at the reduced activity point of this circle. So their world is becoming smaller because they're not doing as much with this onset of a chronic condition. And we find ourselves engaging in less activity, perhaps out of fear or embarrassment because we no longer feel like we know our limitations. And as we begin to do less, our balance abilities diminish and that muscle weakness occurs. And this places us at greater risk for falls, and it may even contribute a fear of falling that wasn't there before, particularly if a fall does happen. And then a fear of falling can greatly limit activities, allowing major mobility issues to appear. And if no action is taken at this point, it can lead to an inability to care for ourselves. And that's where that loss of independence comes in and cascades into a whole host of other issues. So enough with the bad news physiology, and the next slide will show us that there are things we can do. So we talked a little bit about this under the contributing falls, what contributes to falls. Make your home safer. There, if you missed the webinar on Tuesday or don't have time for the recording, AARP does have a home fit guide that you can download or have them send to you for free. From their website, and I believe that's in our resource guide, walks you through your home and simple things that you can look at around the home that will make it more fall prevention friendly. Talking with your provider or your pharmacist, speaking up. I know Aaron mentioned earlier, there are so many who may not even mention to their provider at the next checkup that they had a fall because they're well aware of the cascading possibilities that might happen, but really being honest with your provider so that things can be taken, what you need is addressed. Very important. Reviewing those medications with your provider, checking your eyes regularly and updating your eyeglasses if it's needed. We talked about the role of vision contributing to falls, so staying on top of that, very key. And keep moving. And that's where Fit and Fall Proof comes in to play. Just doing something regularly, activities that are functional within your day, and have you practicing pushing, walking, starting and stopping, bending, things that are functional within your day-to-day life. So the reason if we're beginning with an assistive device, sometimes I get that question, you know, can that contribute to falls further? And the short answer is working with a PT so that it's properly fit and you know your steps and how you're using it properly. absolutely contributes to strength and confidence to move. And some people even move beyond that to where they don't need the device anymore, but obviously very individualized situation. So talking about the Fit and Fall Proof program, we'll go to the next slide. You can see several things that have been listed by participants as experiences, increasing strength, etc. 7 out of 10 participants report improvements in their physical functioning. That's contributing to their activities of daily living. And the kind of the side bonus of this is that 3 in 4 report an increase in their energy level or improved mental health. Now that is after a 10-week session. So to get benefits, you have to stick with it a little bit, but know that it will pay off. Next slide, please. Fit and Fall Proof specifically is an Idaho program started in 2004, exercise that is focused on functional movements for older adults, 60 plus, but we don't put a stringent limit on that. We get together 2 to 3 times a week, and we're there for 45 to 60 minutes each time. We do perform a measure of performance at the beginning and end of our 10-week sessions called the tug test, very simple to do. And you're able to register through your local health district. If you end up stopping by a class and talking to one of the leaders, they will get you all situated as well. So don't feel like, I don't want to put a barrier there. Feel free to stop by and check it out. Next slide, please. We do have a few testimonials, and for the sake of time, I probably won't read through these, but know that all across the state, we hear over and over again different reasons that this program works. And it's not only ability level that changes, but it's instances where the distance to drive to physical therapy is really impractical after a certain amount of time. And this is the way in a rural area that someone can continue and have that network of support to keep moving. Next slide, please. So we'll go through a few preparatory statements on the next slide. Just some things to consider, and this goes for today. It also goes for if you're getting onto AARP and seeing some of the exercises at home that they offer. Always make sure that you have a phone nearby. You have emergency numbers in large print and or posted to your refrigerator if someone would need to help you. If you're a diabetic, make sure you keep those things nearby that you need, perhaps glucose tabs. And if you're in the class, let your instructors know if there are certain conditions before anything might happen. Say you have atrial fibrillation or diabetes, it's good for them to at least know potentially why you might need some assistance. Also, not just for safety, but exercising with someone nearby is a great idea for them to know what you're doing for safety reasons, but sometimes they'll hold you accountable too. So as we get to moving here, know that the exercises we're doing are going to be in the resource guide. So feel free to just follow along and then you can refer to that later. I'm going to take a minute here to adjust my video so that I can get up and move. So please feel free to do the same. And you will want a chair to be near so that we can talk about a few things we can do to keep ourselves flexible, mobile, strong, I might just adjust my camera here. Okay, I think that looks probably pretty good. Feel free to let me know if you can't see me. I know sometimes when I have that, blurred background, it's hard to see, but.
I would tell you that you look good to me, Kate, but I'm not always the best judge of that.
Okay. Well, let's get started. This is just going to be a sample of what you might see in a fit and fall proof class. It's very condensed so that we have time during the seminar. So we're going to begin with some warm-up, and I like the numbers game. So let's just start knowing that our home base is side-to-side stepping. So if at any time I get distracted and you need to stay moving, though I'm not telling you what to do, you come back to home base, side-to-side stepping, okay? So let's begin. The numbers game is going to have a series of five exercises. Remember, we're warming up. This first one is going to just be little steps, and we're combining it with some shoulder circles. I'm going to go to the back of my shoulders. Little steps, shoulder circles. This is number one. Number two is marching. So we're picking those knees up a bit more, and we're swinging our arms. I can feel my belly need to engage when I do this. Again, this chair is next to you, so if you want to swing only one arm and hold the chair, do what you can. Number three is our drum major. So we're still picking our knees up, but our arms are out to the side, right arm out, left arm comes to our chest, and then we switch. And we're still moving those knees. Drum major, number three. Number four, you can choose either to keep doing little steps or have your feet still. You're going to take your hands and dive down in front of you, bringing your fingers back up like you're making a wave. So your palms are out away from you, down and back up, down and back up, at your own pace. Number four, dolphin dives. Great. Number five is our sumo. So we are going to act like this big, tough sumo wrestler. Our elbows are out in front and our fists are up. We have a little partial squat here, and we're taking our right leg with a diagonal step up and over to the right, and then left up and over to the left. We're keeping our torso nice and straight, head up. So now I'm going to call things out by the number. What was number one? Little steps, shoulder circles. Let's go forward this time. What was number two? Marching, lifting those knees, getting those elbows swinging. Great. Number three, what were we doing? Drum major. Excellent. And lift your knees only as good as it feels to you. You can lift a bit more and pause if you want more work on balance today. If not, and it's more of a warm-up, you can just make it short and quick. Number four. Dolphin dives. Great. Number five, sumo. And some classes really like to make sound effects too, but I'll save you from that.
Thanks for that, Kate.
So the idea there is that then after going through those, I'm coming back to home base here, side to side stepping, so I stay moving. And we could go through them randomly so that we're integrating our brain even more. And we have to remember two, what was five, what was one. So we like to slip a little bit of that in there. We don't get away without our pop quizzes. Now that we are warmed up pretty well, let's do a little bit of what you would see for balance and body resistance exercises. If you like, this is the part where you use your chair a little bit more, so you can have one hand on your chair. We have our foot flexed. That means it's flat. And we're just going to lift our hip up. I'm standing on my right leg and lifting my left hip up. So often we will experience maybe some low back pain, and maybe we really don't have a lot of mobility in this hip sacral area. Let's switch to the other side. Stand on our left foot and raise that right hip up. It's just a couple of inches off the floor. One of the parts that we just don't seem to move as much gets ignored. Slap and tap is what we'll do next. I'm going to stand on my left leg. I can hold the chair with my left hand if I like. My right leg is back, extended. My right arm is extended in front of me. So I'm this nice diagonal. And I'm bringing them together in front. So I'm lifting my knee to my hand and vice versa. And the longer, the more you slow this down, the longer you have to balance while you're doing it. If you're feeling really great on this leg today, you can let go of the chair. Let's do two more. And switch to the other leg. Standing on my right leg, left one extended, left arm extended, bring them together. We're usually doing about eight on each side. Great. I like the next one. It's called Step Around the Clock. We have to think about the clock, right? So I'm standing on my right leg. I'm going to put my left leg in front of me at noon, and then 9, 6, 9, 6, 11, 8, 10, 7, noon. Wonderful. Let's work the other side. Standing on our left leg, right toe points forward at noon, then at 3, 6, 3, noon, 6, 1, 4, 5, 3, noon. Wonderful. You know, getting up from the chair is one of those best measures. So we just have to throw in a little bit of squat called the clapper. So in your chair, come to the front of the edge of your chair. And if you need, feel free to push off the chair with both hands as you stand up, and then do the clapping behind your back. We're going to start seated. Our hands come up over our head to clap, and then we stand up and clap behind us. So back down, light as a feather, clap overhead, engage those belly muscles as you stand up. And you go at your own pace. If you can practice anything at home, this, with or without the hands overhead and behind, is number one. Insert just a few sit to stands every day. It will make you stronger. Okay. To work ourselves in a direction that we may not all the time, we are going to do ta-da. So if we think about how we move forward a lot in our life, right? Do we move diagonally very much? Maybe not. So let's take steps diagonally. Two, let's start to the left. We're going to take our left foot forward diagonally, and our left arm will go up at the same time. Ta-da! And really stretch it out. And then on the right side, ta-da. This means that we need to balance for a brief bit here as we take that diagonal step. And even while we're reaching, maybe we're reaching into a cupboard. This is good practice. Ta-da. Great.
I think what I really like about this, Kate, is they're all things, like you said, that are things that we do every day, like reaching into cupboards and having to stand up and sit down.
Right. Functional movements. It's just, and if you've ever heard the term muscle memory, we are helping our bodies build or maintain that muscle memory because maybe we don't do certain things anymore that we used to. So we need to practice them and keep our bodies able to do these things, move in these different planes.
And what about cooling down, Kate? A lot of people kind of skip that part.
Yes, cooling down, so important. Particularly, that's why we insert that home base exercise, because we don't want to just stop movement all of a sudden. So we're going to begin our cool down with a holding up the sky. And you can choose to keep that sidestepping, or you can be in place and reach. I'm doing my left arm way up to the ceiling, flat palm, right palm down towards the floor. Reaching up and down. And then we're going to switch. Right arm up, left arm down. Take a nice deep breath and bring them both to relax. Let's try a shirt pull. So cross your wrists at your waistband. Act like you're pulling your shirt overhead and raise both arms up so that they're not crossed. Bring your arms down. Raise them up again. Down, and we'll do one more. Up, overhead. Down. After some of that leg work, you may want to stretch out the back of your thighs. So you can do this either seated or standing. I'm standing on my right leg. Left heel is out. Toes are pulled back towards me. And I'm just leaning into that stretch. You should feel a nice little pull on the back of your leg. If you need more, all you do is lean forward.
And you know, maybe I'm odd, but I love the feel of stretching muscles. Lets me know they're there and that I'm taking care of them. So I love everything that you did, Kate. And what I really like is I'm the kind of person that can come sit down at 6 a.m. and I get into my work, and next thing it's literally 8 hours later and I haven't gotten up. But all of these things that you've done are things that we all can do at any time during our day, whether we're working or we're at home. Sometimes, you know, when the commercials come on, that's when I'll stand up and do a set of exercises because it gives me a few minutes. So I want to thank you, Kate, for all of that. Remember, everybody, that that will all be in the resource guide, plus some that we did not have a chance to get to. But we are running out of time, unfortunately. So let me get us back to where we need to be, which is something like this. Just wanted to remind everybody that Kate gave us a really good broad overview of some of the causes of falls and what we can do about them. Again, more depth is happening on Tuesday. It's actually a 90-minute seminar, and we have healthcare professionals from around the state that are joining us for that. You get a lot of information. You can register for that. Guess where? aging.idaho.gov/falls. Hopefully you're gonna get that one memorized. The other thing is just to remember that you can follow us on social media, also available in the resource guide and on our website. And finally, I want to thank Kate for all of her activities and her information. I think it's great. I enjoyed it even better than last year, which is always a good way to make progress. Also, as a reminder, all of you have access to information, falls prevention programs such as nutrition, transportation, help with chores, housekeeping, by contacting your local area agency on aging or your AAA that are listed here. Their contact information is available on our website, as well as in your resource guide. And they also can find the workshops. So self-management of diabetes and chronic pain, all of which Kate said can impact our falls risk. So that is about the time that we have today. Again, I want to thank everybody for being here. It really is the first of many, hopefully, simple steps that you'll take to reduce your falls risk. And we hope that you certainly have a falls-free rest of your day. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you for joining us. This has been a production brought to you by the Idaho Commission on Aging, supporting well-being for aging Idahoans since 1968. For more information on resources to stay at home, stay healthy, stay safe, and to stay informed, visit our website at www.aging.idaho.gov.